Okay, it's a pleasure to have, let's welcome Diane Purichard. She got her PhD in Toulouse, and then she was in Vienna for 2 years, I think, working in my former group, where I did my PhD. And recently she got hired by INRIA, and so she went back now to France. Now she's in Paris with lots of different projects, and that is one of those, I guess. And it's about...
Not at INRIA.
Okay. It's about modeling tissue self-organization and the fate of injury outcome. So please, Diane.
Thank you, Dietmar, for the nice introduction. And I thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk in front of you today. So I'm going to talk about a project that was initiated during my PhD and that gives some... few more works. I know that it's the end of the day, end of the conference, so I will not bother you with the fancy mathematical analysis, but rather try to come to show you how we can model, develop a mathematical framework to answer, or at least to give clues about mechanisms happening in biological systems. So my talk will be divided into two parts. So the first part, we will explore the mechanisms of adipose tissue morphogenesis that I will explain after. And in the second part, we will use this model to, we will push forward this model to explore the fate of injury outcome. So first, let me give you an overview of the project. So we were interested in understanding the mechanisms involved in adipose tissue morphogenesis. So morphogenesis is a term that refers to all the mechanisms that are in place and which enable a biological system to reach its equilibrium. So you will start with nothing, basically, or a lot of things that will self-organize and give some specific structures that afterwards will be maintained all along the tissue life. And this last sentence is referred to as homeostasis. It's the maintain of equilibrium state. So why adipose tissue? For a long time, that's just been considered in the biological side as a passive energy store, but now it is widely accepted that it has it is an important endocrine organ that has a lot of consequences in the immune system or in various diseases. And experimentally, it is quite easy, really accessible for the experiments. And also it has other properties that will serve us for our second part of the talk, is that it has been discovered quite recently that adipose-derived stem cells that are non-differentiated cells having the ability to differentiate into specific cells that have functionalities are present in this tissue and can serve for regenerative medicine. So, and these stem cells are way more easy to use for regenerative medicine, contrary to, for instance, the mesenchymal stem cells that are in the bone marrow. So all this made us took an interest into this adipose tissues. And here are two pictures of this tissue. So on the left side, you have a whole adipose tissue extracted from a mouse, healthy mouse, and adult mouse. And on the right, you have a zoom in the structure. So what we see in these tissues is the differentiated cells that are the adipocytes in red here. And they are clustered into these specific structures called lobules into an organized fiber network that is in blue around. And what we see also is these green dots that are the stem cells that can become adipocytes if the organism needs to store more energy. So as we can see, these lobules are very specific structures. And if we look closely into the macroscopic scale, into the tissue scale, we can see different levels of organization according to where we are in the tissue. We have zones where the lobules are very elongated, zones where they are round like rugby balls, and zones where we can't barely see anything. So, so we have several scales to study the system. So when we want to answer a biological question, mathematical models are really useful because these systems, all the biological systems, have a huge complexity in terms of number of different agents, in terms of scaling, at which scale do you want to look at the system? Do you want to look at the whole tissue? Do you want to look at the cell? Do you want to zoom into the cell and look at the genetics? And you have different interactions, mechanics, chemicals, etc. So building a mathematical model enables you to reduce the complexity and to explore some mechanisms that you have decided, I mean, that you do the hypothesis that they are the main mechanisms involved in this system. So this is what we did with the biologists. We defined heuristic rules, and now I will present you our model that we wanted to be as simple as possible. So our first hypothesis is that adipose tissue is composed of fibers and cells. So these are the only agents that we consider. So the fiber is represented as a segment with a center YF and an orientation angle theta F that are rigid. And the cell is supposed to be a 2D sphere with a center XI and a radius RI. Now we have to decide the heuristic rules, so what happens in the tissue according to us. So we suppose that two fibers that are crossing have the ability to form a crosslink. This crosslink K will be maintained all along his life. It will be created randomly in the set of crossing fibers, and it can be deleted also with frequencies that are parameters of the model. Now, we consider the insemination of new cells to model stem cell differentiation, so apparition of new cells with a minimal radius. And then we model cell growth, so our cells grow until a maximal radius that is fixed also as a parameter. So these are the only biological phenomena that we take into account to be as simple as possible. And now we describe the mechanics of the tissue. So our main hypothesis in this model is to say that the self-organization in adipose tissue is mainly due to mechanical aspects. So these are the mechanical elements that we take into consideration. As we see in the images, the fiber network is really around the adipocyte lobules. It's not inside the lobules. So basically what we say is that fibers and cells repulse each other. It's an hypothesis that we make. Also, we suppose that the cross-link proteins between two fibers generate a potential that tends to align these two fibers. So we have this potential that will align them. And finally, to model the fact that fat is an incompressible fluid, we suppose that the two cells cannot overlap. So this is volume exclusion, quite common in the systems. So how can we obtain the equations of motion? The mechanical elements will define a global potential of the systems, so that comprise all these three type of interaction, and that I will describe later. And the volume exclusion between cells is supposed to be a constraint, so cells can never overlap. So it is a constraint in the minimization problem. And the cross-linking constraint, so the fact that the fibers can move and turn but have to keep their attachment site, is also seen as a constraint. So it's a hardcore potential. So we suppose that the elements will move towards the minimization of the total energy of the systems that is defined by the mechanical elements. So it's a minimization under constraint. It's a non-convex problem, so mathematically we can't say if there exists a unique solution. So we solve it numerically. But first, let me go into more details about this mechanical potential. So to solve this problem, we use the Lagrangian of the system. So we write the mechanical potential plus the constraint multiplied by the Lagrangian multipliers. This is quite common as a method. So the mechanical potential is first composed of the mechanical fiber cell potential that I talked before. And to define it, we suppose that each fiber has a repulsive zone around it in the form of an ellipse that we control the width with this parameter tau. So the more tau, the more the fiber will repulse far the cell. Now, the fiber alignment is just a function that is the square sinus of the difference of the angle. So we see that minimizing this function would lead the two angles to be the same, so that align the fibers. Okay, so these are for the mechanical elements. Now, volume exclusion is modeled with a simple functional that is just the distance between the center minus the sum of the radius. So this non-overlapping constraint is an inequality constraint, because as long as this function is positive, then we are overlapping. And finally, the cross-linked constraint is defined by this functional V between the pairs of cross-linked fibers. So during the motion of minimization, you have the cross-link, so the fibers will be pushed, and we want them to maintain their attachment site. So what we do is that we define the function V as the distance of the two attachment sites, and say that as a constraint, this function should be zero. So this is just the distance of two points that should be nil. So this is equality constraint for the cross-links. So okay, now we have all the elements of the model, and we can recursively solve our minimization. So what happens in our model, just to sum up, you have biological phenomena that disturb the equilibrium. For instance, a cell will appear on another cell, or fibers will cross-link and want to align. And then at each time step, discrete time step, you solve this minimization algorithm so that you reach your minimal energy configuration. So more details about the biological phenomena. So cell growth is supposed to be a regular process, and we model it with a linear volumic growth. Then stem cell differentiation is just the apparition of new cells. It's supposed to be a random process. So we model it with a Poisson process with a frequency that is a parameter of the model, that is nu f. Now, for the localization of insemination, we have several choices. We can either do it randomly in the model, say that all adipocytes can appear with the same probability everywhere, or we can explore another hypothesis that we wanted to study, is that the role of vasculature in this tissue. So there is a whole community that think that vasculature appears first in the tissue, and then the adipocytes differentiate near the blood vessels. What we wanted to show is a new paradigm where the vasculature could be secondary to this organization. So how can we take into consideration vasculature in our model is to make the probability of appearing for the adipocytes close to existing adipocytes. So this is a way of taking into account vasculature, in the sense of we say that there are blood vessels when adipocytes appear, and then you have more probability to appear around, saying that there is a nutrient here. So we give ourselves the possibility to have this biased insemination or random insemination. And finally, the creation suppression of fiber crosslinks is supposed to be Poisson processes also, frequencies nu f and nu d. And this parameter, which will be very important in our simulation, as we will see, is closely related to the total number of links in the model. So I would refer to it as the fraction of number of links. So now, let's look at simulations. We have all the ingredients of our model. So we consider, yes, I didn't say it, but it's a 2D model, of course, because we want to stay simple. So we consider a square domain with periodic boundary conditions on all the sides. And we start with a randomly distributed fiber network and randomly cross-linked also. And then we let the simulation appear. And of course, you have to, of course, imagine that for every biological phenomena, we have at least one model parameter. So we have a lot of model parameters, and they have an influence on the final structures that we have. So for instance, here in this simulation, I consider a fiber network that is not really dynamic. That means that the links will be maintained all over the simulation. So they don't disappear, basically. The nu d, the frequency of disappearing, is very, very small. And what we see, we have stem cell differentiation, and what we see is that the cells will have the tendency to push the fibers, and inversely, the fibers push the cells also. And this will create zones of zero potential that will attract the other adipocytes. So this is with a random insemination, so cells appear everywhere. And then they organize because of our mechanical elements. So this is very close to what we can observe in biological systems. And this is quite interesting. And if now we consider a system that has that has more links, actually it's quite the same structure. So I will not spend too much time here. So now what I do in this simulation here is that I increase the number, the frequency of suppressing the links, maintaining the number of links. So here the system is highly dynamical. The ECM, the extracellular matrix, is dynamical. So what happens is that the links generate alignment, and so every fiber aligns, and this gives directionality to the cluster of cells. As we can see, they are more elongated and everywhere and less organized than before. And why didn't we have that for the first simulation? Is that the links were maintained in the simulation. So they are randomly created at the beginning, and they form these complex interconnected structures. And because they are all linked, then you can't move them. So they create a structure that is stable. And here, on the reverse, then if you can destroy links, then you can increase the number of freedom. And so you have alignment. So this is what we can observe for some simulations. And we wanted to have a more quantitative analysis. So we defined some quantifiers. The goal of these quantifiers is to put numbers on what we see. So on this simulation, we see that here we have lobules that are round and that are well separated, lobules that are elongated. So we want to quantify that. So we keep track of the number of cell clusters and of their elongation, the mean elongation of cell clusters. And for the fibers, what we measure is the mean alignment of the fibers and also the mean elongation. So these are quantifiers numbers that we can obtain for every simulation. And then what we do is that we run a set of simulations playing on the model parameters. For instance, here we play from these different simulations, we play on the number of fraction of linked fibers and the dynamics of the network. So here is a non-dynamical network, and here is more dynamical. And so what we can do when we do that is to compute the quantifiers for each simulation, each model parameter, and then plot their values as curves, and then hopefully cross fingers and find phase transitions that we actually have. So here I plot the elongation of the cells as function of the dynamics of the network. So when we go to the right, then the system is more and more dynamic. The fiber links are more and more dynamic. And what we observe is that the elongation of the cells increases. Then for the alignment of the fiber, we also have an increase when the system becomes more dynamical, and this is in accordance to what we saw in the simulation. And then for the elongation, we have a decrease. So this we did that for, this is just an example on the impact of this new D, so the frequency of unlinking, but we did that for all the parameters, and then we could isolate which parameters had the most influence on the final structures. And actually, it is the dynamics of the tissue. So this is the parameter that has the most importance, the number of links and the dynamics of the tissue. And this is in accordance with some biological experiments that shows that the mechanic properties of the tissue is really of tremendous importance, and I will talk about it later also. So we wanted to go a bit further than that. We wanted also to compute these quantifiers on the biological images, and then so that we can compare quantitatively our simulations with the experiments. So what we did is a bit of image processing. So first, we given an image of an adipose tissue, we were quite lucky because so these images were done by ITAV, image laboratory in Toulouse. We were quite lucky because the cells are visible. As you can see, we don't see the fiber network, so we have no information of the fibers in the biology, but this is something the biologists are looking for. So what we did is develop with the MATLAB processing tool quite simple and complete automatic detection of cells. So given an image, if you give me an image like this, then I can detect all the cells that are present. So I have access to the center of the cells and their radius. Now, what we did also is to try to separate the different clusters. For instance, we had some image like this. This is not quite obvious that there are some clusters, some lobules, because there are a very thin demarcation between the clusters. So we also developed this time a semi-automatic process, semi-automatic in the sense that it will be able to separate clusters that are far from each other. But sometimes it fails. Even the human eye fails to really separate the things. So what we do is that we run our algorithm. We have separation of lobules. And then if we see that that it should be separated, even if it's not, then we do it by hand. So this is semi-automatic process. But it is sufficient for our purpose because we don't have many, many biological images. And also, it enables us to compute the quantifiers, so quantifiers on the cell structure. So this is what we did. We had some images of biological tissues. Then we segment to detect the different lobules. And then we look in our database of simulations. We have like millions of simulations with different parameters. And we look for our simulation that have the quantifiers the closer to the one that we compute on this image. Actually, we can we obtain for each image that the biologist gave us a simulation which was really close, so a set of parameters that could be related to the biological system. So this was quite surprising and encouraging for our model, and it validated quantitatively the simulation with the biological data. So the main, which I didn't talk a lot about, but I will now. The main result of what was the main claim of our study was to say that vasculature organization could be secondary to lobular organization in adipose tissue, and that this formation of lobules can be due to mechanical facts mostly. So we were quite happy about this model, and we wanted to push forwards the study. So we had a lot of perspective at the end of this work. We could turn it to a 3D model, which is more realistic for what we want to study, but also the simulation that I've shown you lasts almost one day each simulation, so it's very expensive. So a 3D model would be even worse. And we thought, we did a derivation of a macroscopic model, given the microscopic model that I presented you before. And we did a derivation of a macroscopic model for the fiber network. So one of the perspectives would be to couple it with the macroscopic model for the cells. And this would give us the ability to model the whole tissue. As you saw on our simulation, because of the time, because it's time expensive, then we have just a part of a tissue. So we would like to have several organizations in the whole tissue. But I will not talk about the derivation of macroscopic model now. I will talk about another project that came after this study. And this was actually the first goal of this study, is to use to understand the mechanisms of tissue disruption. This is why we wanted to understand how morphogenesis work, to know how, if we disrupt the equilibrium, how the system will react. So let me talk about scar formation and regeneration. So human tissues have a natural tendency to form a scar. And this is evolution, Darwinian evolution, because if it is for a system the fastest way to repair, because regeneration is at the cost of a lot of loss of blood and also of pain. So the most of the time, when you have, depending on the size of the wound, of the injury, you will have a fibrosis, so creation of a huge network of fibers, and which will lost the functionalities of the tissue as before. So this is formation of a scar. But some organisms have the ability to regenerate. That means that it recovers the functionalities and the organization exactly as before the injury. And the master of regeneration is this little gal that is an axolot. So it can regenerate a limb, a whole limb, and also organs in his in his body. So we wanted to know which mechanisms can trigger scar or regeneration process. And our main hypothesis with the same biologist from the Stroma lab in Toulouse was to say that the mechanisms after injury are the same as the mechanisms of morphogenesis. So what they have in Stroma lab is some experiments on mice. So they cut, they have a tissue. So these are different mice every time. It's invasive process in this day. So at time zero, they cut half a huge part of the tissue. They create a big injury. And then they look at the system 2 weeks and 1 month after, and even more. And what we can see, depending on the type of mice, is that so usually normal mice do not regenerate. They create a scar, so the tissue stays cannot grow anymore. It creates fibrosis. But some mice have the ability to regenerate their adipose tissue, and what we see is a reconstruction of the tissue. And this reconstruction, even the scar formation, you have three phases after injury. You have a phase of inflammation, where you have a lot of chemicals that will come and appeal for fibroblasts to create some ECM. Then you have proliferation of immune cells and granulation tissue, so you have a tissue that invades the space, which create the remodeling of the ECM. So for scar or for regeneration, you have these three phases. You have first the tissue that builds, and then afterwards that is repopulated by the cells. And this is what we wanted to take into account in our model. So because our hypothesis is that mechanisms of tissue regeneration mirrors development, it makes sense to use the same model and to try to change it as little as possible. So we have the same model with fibers and cells that interact. We consider fiber-cell repulsion, fiber-fiber linking and unlinking, fiber-fiber alignment, and cell-cell non-overlapping. Same mechanisms that happen. What changes in this new model for regeneration? So first, we take a simulation at equilibrium, and we do as the biologists do in the real tissue, and we cut half of the tissue in the middle. Then we have to decide what happens. We can't just let our model run in this because, for instance, we didn't have before tissue formation. No, our fibers didn't appear. We started with a number of fibers and it was fixed. So we have to decide some rules for making fibers appear. So to be as close as possible to the biological reality, what we do is that we consider insemination of new fibers as function of the gradient of the agents. So that would force the new fibers to appear not everywhere in the tissue, but close to the wound. So they would here there is high gradient of agents, and here the gradient is zero. So they will not appear outside, but they will appear here, here and repopulate, and then it will move the gradient, and then the ECM will cover all the hole. Then what we suppose also, we have new elements that we called injury signaling chemicals. So why did we need that? Because we wanted to take into consideration the fact that the SAM appears, so extracellular matrix, appears before the adipocytes. So we suppose that these signals, these chemicals, are created with the same rules as the fibers, so on the border of the rule, and they block adipocyte insemination. So adipocyte can only appear where there is no chemical signals. So we create them as long as there is a gradient, and then they have a finite lifetime. So when the fibers will repopulate the wound, then the gradient will be zero, the chemicals will disappear, and then adipocytes can differentiate. This is the scenario that we want to model. So these chemicals are supposed to diffuse through the tissue, so they are created somewhere where there is high gradient, and then they move towards on the fibers, on the fiber network. And then they disappear because of their death finite lifetime. Okay. And I just talked about cell differentiation, so it waits for the chemicals to disappear before appearing. Okay, so this is our model. We just added these rules for what happens after the injury. And then we can look at what the simulations does. So of course, we have even more model parameters now because we have parameters for after injury. So what we looked at is a different simulation. So the dynamics of the tissue is maintained before and after injury. So if you have a tissue that that has a slow linking and linking, this will be true also after injury. It's the same parameters. So here it's the case. We model regular tissue, so the matrix has low remodeling rate. So once you create a link, it stays for a long time. Then, so what we do, it's quite fast because I didn't want the movie to last really long. So this is the time of injury. We just delete all the agents here. Then you have repopulation by the fibers, and then the chemicals that are in purple disappear, and the cells can appear. So in this case, frequency of, as you saw, the fibers appear really fast in the model. And this is because the frequency is really high. This is like non-realistic, but to see what happens. And what I didn't say also, there is a new rule, sorry. The fibers that appear have also the probability to be linked to their neighbors. And here, we have no link. So you see all the fibers are in blue, and it's quite clear that they are not linked. This is also a very important parameter. I'm really sorry for forgetting it. So here we have no link. The new fibers are created and they are not linked to anyone. And we see that because of this no link, then all the adipocytes appear everywhere. So if now we make the fiber be very linked once they are created, then what happens is that it blocks also cell differentiation because cell cannot appear where the tissue is too linked. And it's because the stiffness is too increased and so the adipocytes cannot appear. So in this case, what we see is that we have a population of the creation, very fast creation of a very connected network which blocks the apparition of adipocytes. And this resembles a scar. This is what we call a scar. Because if we compare the final and initial state, then we see that we have way less adipocytes and that we have a lot of fibers in the injury zone. So now, what we can play on again is a small reconstruction speed. In the previous simulation, then the fibers appeared really fast. So now we decrease this frequency. And what we have in this case is simulations like this. So if we compare before and after, with such a frequency, if the fibers that appear are linked enough, then we have regeneration. So of course, it's not exactly the same structures. We can't because there are a lot of stochastic processes. But we have the same type of structures. Now, with this same simulation, if we increase the number of links of the new fiber, then what we have is not the creation of a scar because we still have adipocytes at the end, but an unorganized tissue. So to quantify a bit what we have in the influence of the model parameters. We can also look at highly dynamical tissue. So in the simulations before, this one and this one, once the links are created, then they have a long lifetime. So what we can do is also make an injury in a tissue that is highly dynamical, but the links move, disappear and appear. And in this case, what we can observe is regeneration when the frequency of appearance of fibers is slow. So this is, we recover the structures before injury. And if we make them appear very fast, what is surprising is that in this case, not surprising actually, but is that we can't have the formation of a scar here. So to obtain a scar for the previous simulations, we needed to bring a lot of fibers very fast and to cross-link them, which is quite okay. And here, because it's a dynamical tissue, even if you have the very fast construction of interconnected network, because these links are dynamical, they disappear and reappear, then they allow the remodeling of the network. And in this case, you have the reformation of a tissue, which is completely far from the tissue at the beginning, but still, you don't have a scar. So what we showed with this result is that if the dynamics of the tissue is a very important parameter for scar formation and for regeneration. And to quantify this a bit more, we used our quantifiers that we had for the previous model, and we studied their value before at time equilibrium after injury minus at time before injury. So we want this function gamma, which is the difference of elongation of cells, alignment of fibers, number of cell cluster, and number of cells, to be as small as possible to have regeneration. If it's zero, that means that the at the end we have exactly the same quantifiers as before the injury. So the smaller is, the closer we are to regeneration, and the larger, the closer we are to scar formation. So now we can plot this this global error as function of the model parameters, and we plotted it as function of the cross-link of the new fibers. So this PF is the parameter that says that the larger is, the more cross-linked the new network is. So if we have no link, we see that we are in the middle zone where there is no organization of the tissue. There is some reconstruction. It's not a scar. It's not regeneration. It's just an unorganized tissue that is quite far from the beginning. We don't have lobules at the end. If we increase a little bit, we let the new fibers have the ability to cross-link with their neighbors, then we have a small zone of parameters where you can obtain the regeneration, and it's here. So you have enough links, but not too much, and in this case, you can regenerate. And then if you have a lot of links, so the new network you create is very strongly connected, then you can have the formation of a scar. This is for tissues that are non-dynamical. It means when you create a link, it stays here for a long time. If you do the same computations on highly dynamical tissues, what you observe is that you don't have scar formation independently on the parameters. So you have a huge, larger zone of regeneration for this tissue. So the dynamical tissues have a ability to regenerate that is increased compared to the other tissues, but you can't form a scar, at least according to our simulations. So this is quite interesting and quite close to what is observed in biological systems. What is the most interesting is that the regenerative mice has an adipose tissue different from the non-regenerative mice. And what we observe in their tissue, the ones that can regenerate, is that the fiber network is really thin. It corresponds to the lobules that are really close to each other, where we can't barely see the distinction. And this, for our simulation, corresponds to highly dynamical tissues. If we increase the dynamics, then the clusters, the fibers are more aligned, and the network is more thin. And for all simulations with highly dynamical systems, we have easier regeneration. So we can make a parallel with what they observe in biology. So to conclude, the most important parameters that we saw in our model was the parameters linked to the dynamics, to the cross links of the ECM. And this is something that needs to be proved by experiments. So there are a lot of perspectives to this model. So the main message of this second part is that rigidity, ECM rigidity may detect the choice between regeneration or scar formation. And there are a lot of perspectives. So we would like to do a quantitative validation of the model as we did for the model for morphogenesis. So really compare the experiments before and after injury with real experiments. And we would need some data on the fiber network. This is what we really miss, because we can compare the lobule structures, but we would need really information of these cross-linking proteins, because we don't know many things biologically on this tissue. This is what we were motivated to do a mathematical model, and it would really help to have some biological data on these cross-link proteins. Yes, so this is the second part. And we still have this perspective that stays to develop a 3D model that would be computationally expensive, but it's in our mind and will be the subject of future work for sure. So I will now thank my collaborators on this project, so the teams in Stroma Lab, and then Pierre Degon from Imperial College London, and Fanny de Rebecque from the EMT in Toulouse, and I thank you for your attention.